all of the Buddhist teachings, the Buddha's teachings, have the aim, have the one goal, have the intention to help us end suffering, to see clearly where we're suffering, where we're unhappy, where we're not at ease, where we're not free, where we're not, and to see what's causing that. First Noble Truth, turn towards the suffering, acknowledge it, break any denial, minimalization, ways that we're ignoring, denying. Second Noble Truth, see what's causing the suffering, the craving, the aversion, the self-centeredness. Third Noble Truth, it's possible to get free through our own efforts in this lifetime. Nibbana or Nirvana, happiness, ease, freedom, it's an option. It's a very, it's the carrot, right? It's the sort of like, you can do this, but it's not so simple. Many of us have been meditating for decades and kind of we see like, oh yeah, I suffer less, but this end of suffering promise of Buddhism can feel a little elusive, the end of the path. But the traditional teaching is full liberation. And the Eightfold Path, which is this is what needs to be done. And I know you heard me in the instructions of really our aspiration is what do I need to do? First of all, like we come to practice, you know, before we learn about this method and we feel like, well, I'm suffering and I don't even know what to do about it. I didn't even know why. It must be all my fault or it's just the human condition or... And then if you have been studying Buddhism for a little while, come to some classes, read some books, it becomes clear pretty soon. You see, oh, this is what I need to do. I need to stop clinging to impermanent phenomena, thoughts, feelings, relationships, like non-attachment, not just a good idea, it's an actual practice, actual skill to develop. So we know what to do, but then it's developing the ability to do it. Compassion, not just a good idea, not just a philosophy, an embodied skill that takes quite a while to become, to get good at. Actually meeting our own pain with compassion or the pain, the ignorance in the world with compassion. It's counterintuitive. Our instinctual drive is to hate pain and to hate people who cause pain to us or others. And compassion and forgiveness is a very radical proposal. It's completely, as the dude said, against the stream, against the norm. So those basics are important, and some new people tonight, and those are the basics. Stop clinging, develop compassion. You'll be much happier. You'll suffer much less. If it were only so simple. I think that because of the political climate, I was thinking of the marches last weekend, and the election inauguration, and it feels like there's a real increased level of suffering. I think it's true. There's an increased level of suffering. Because there's been an increased level of awareness. And I think that there's one way to look at it, is that actually all of the ignorance that people are suffering about is not new ignorance. It's not like all of a sudden there's a whole bunch of racist, sexist, fascists in office. I mean, it's a pretty big shift from Obama to Trump. I mean, huge shift. But it's not a huge shift in our world that, you know, the billionaire there's not a lot of, it's not like there's brand new ignorance. It's not like there's brand new fascism. It's not like all of a sudden, it's just been, somebody said it's just that the veil has been pulled back and our country has empowered, what is it, the greater of two evils. You always try to vote for the lesser of two evils, right? I do. I always try to vote for the lesser. Like, these people are both terrible. Which one is less terrible?
One is less skilled.
Yeah, skilled, yes. That's a more skillful way to put that. And so it had me thinking about hell realms and the Buddhist cosmology about, so there's this whole methodology. The whole teaching is we can free ourselves from suffering. And mostly the Four Noble Truths is pointing towards the internal causes of human suffering. The repetitive craving for it to be different than it is. A lack of acceptance, a lack of wisdom, a lack of compassion for pain, a presence of craving for it to be different is the cause of human unhappiness from the inside. And then that internal craving manifests as every form of greed, hatred, delusion, corruption, every ism is coming from that human instinctual drive that is driven by craving and aversion. And then it becomes racism, and then it becomes sexism, and it becomes classism, and it becomes systematic oppressive factors in our society, all from the human survival instinct, out of control. No wisdom, no compassion, no awareness of what's driving us. And it becomes anger, and becomes fear, and becomes control. So one of the ways that the Buddha talked about it was this path to liberation was actually getting liberated from samsara. And so we've currently incarnated in samsara. Samsara is defined as the realms, the six realms, that are fueled by greed, hatred, and delusion. And that as long as you have taken birth in one of the six realms, you will suffer some. You will have some greed and some hatred and some delusion, and you'll suffer in different ways depending on which realm you are born into. The human realm that we're supposed to be in right now, that can sometimes feel like a hell realm or a ghost, you know, can feel not so human, and some humans can appear to be not so human. But the definition of the human realm is that there's a balance here. There's supposed to be, if this is the human realm, there's supposed to be a balance. There's pain, there's sorrow, there's grief, there's loss. It's impermanent. We're all subject to sickness, aging, and death. And there's enough pain in this human realm to motivate us to find a spiritual refuge, a reliable refuge beyond the material or the physical body. There's enough dissatisfaction in the human realm to motivate us. But also in the human realm, there's enough joy. There's enough beauty and love and pleasure to sustain us. And the human mind and body have the appropriate sort of setup to be mindful. You can train yourself to change your relationship to pleasure and pain and politics and society. And you can get free in this human realm. It's considered the ideal form for liberation. because there's enough suffering to motivate you to want freedom, but there's enough joy in the human capacity for embodiment and wisdom and becoming wise and skillful and compassionate. We can do it in this form. It's ideal. We have the motivation, the capacity, the ability. And there's all of these wonderful experiences along the way too. Pleasure. The other realm in the cosmology that is visible to us, if we take this teaching literally, human realm, and then there's the animal realm. Your cats and dogs, your, the birds and the bees and the mammals and the, all of the animals, non-human sentient beings that we see, that we know, some of which we love, some of which we are afraid of, the sharks and the tigers and the predators. And the animal realm is considered to be a realm of survival instinct and fear and craving and not a lot of choice, not a lot of free will. I'm hungry, I have to eat, I will kill to eat. I will murder to eat. And food chain, really clearly in the food chain, you don't see many animals growing vegetables, although some animals do eat vegetables. There are vegetarians. Like an impulsive realm of existence. Most of the sexuality in animal realms is non-consensual. Somebody was telling me about dolphins the other day. Said like dolphins gang rape?
Yeah.
And everybody's like, oh, dolphins, they're so beautiful. They're so smart. And somebody, they were showing me like dolphins gang rape and they are also like necrophiliacs. They will also like rape dead animal, dead fish. And they rape the puffer fish.
Oh.
Did you know that? That they do something to like, they somehow they like get the puffer fish and they get high off of it somehow. So they like take it and they like suck it and then they pass it around. Dolphins are vicious. Dolphins are rapists. I know some of you have that nice little dolphin tattoo. Sorry to break it to you. And I know also some of you, when we hear about the animal realm, you think, well, my dog has got the best life. My cat has the best incarnation. Well, he just meditates all day on my meditation cushion, favorite place, just chilling, eating weird food, but comfortable. So some animal lovers like to kind of argue that the animal realm is seen as a lower realm, and it's actually quite hard to develop compassion as an animal. It's quite hard to develop wisdom, to understand impermanence, to not take everything personal, these sort of liberating qualities in the animal realm. It's hard to meditate, is the traditional view. But the human beings, with our neocortex, we have the appropriate kind of brain for developing the wisdom and compassion necessary to become free from samsara. So the picture that I'm trying to paint is that greed, hatred, and delusion fuels in the art. There's a wheel, and then the wheel is cut up into six realms. And in the center is greed, hatred, and delusion. And it's what is keeping the wheel of samsara turning. And this term samsara literally means something like that, the wandering, a realm of wandering. Samsara means you're wandering from kind of suffering to suffering, incarnation to incarnation, realm to realm. Human realm and animal realm as what we see. And then there's below, the kind of another lower realm, there's a realm called the hungry ghost realm. And the hungry ghost realm is considered and pictured as realms where there's these giant bodies, and it's a realm of abundance. There's actually everything. There's food. There's a buffet, and these beings with really large bodies who need a lot of, but they have pinhole mouths and straw necks. So there's little tiny thin necks and a pinhole mouth. So no matter what, they just can't get sustained. They can't get satisfied. They can't. So it's constant. The hungry ghosts are hungry. And there's nothing, you know, it's like a torturous mind state to just be in constant craving, even though you have everything you need. You can't get it in. You can't get enough in at a time to satisfy you. Sound familiar? I mean, the lowest realm on this sort of hierarchy of samsaric existence are hell realms. And that there's different kinds of hell realms, but it's kind of what you would think from your Judeo-Christian conditioning. Fire and brimstone, and some of the Buddhist hell realms are fiery ones. Some of the Buddhist hell realms are icy. What do you choose? Fire, or you want to freeze your ass off, or burn?
Freeze.
Do I get a parka? Do I? And the hell realms are, it's just pain. Whether it's cold pain or hot pain, it's realms where there's very little, if any, pleasant experience. It's just a painful, kind of consistent painful experience. Above the human realm, there is a realm called the jealous gods. And like the hungry ghost realm, it's a realm of abundance. But these jealous gods, they're called asuras. Jealous gods have everything that they need, more than they need, total abundance. And they have regular bodies, human-looking bodies that can eat what they want, and sexual satisfaction, and material, and sensual, and, you know, they can have their homes, everything. Then there's only one thing in the jealous gods realm that they can't have. And the way that it's pictured is that there's a some sort of tree, fruit-bearing tree, that is planted in the jealous gods realm. But like, so this is, say we are the jealous gods, but then it goes through the ceiling and upstairs is the heaven realm. And it's kind of a little bit of a transparency, like a glass ceiling, let's say. And so you can see the fruit up there and you can see the gods upstairs enjoying it, and you're just at war with for something you don't need. Actually, you have everything here except for papaya. That's it. They have papaya, and your jealousy, you know, you have mangoes and you have pineapple and you have all kinds of delicious things, but no papaya. And, you know, sometimes, often when I'm giving this talk, I talk about America as a jealous God realm. That it's easy to sort of look at our country of having so much abundance and gross national product and all of that, the empire of the United States. But that it's always kind of, but we need oil and we need more and whatever it is, we need more, it's not enough. And we need to grow our national product, and we need to oppress other people, and we need to, you know, let's get it done cheaper in China, and how can we make more? And it's really that jealous God, like, actually, living wages would be fine, like, it's okay if we don't create another bunch of billionaires. It's okay. But actually, I'm thinking, and the way that I mostly, so then there's the heaven realm. Heaven realm, jealous gods, humans, animals, hungry ghosts, hell realms. I'm not sure I believe that these are literal realms of existence. They might be. This is Buddhists, which I'm supposed to be one of. Many Buddhists believe in that this is a literal teaching of realms that you can literally be reborn into. Based on your karma in this lifetime, you could go to hell. Now, here's the good and bad news. Based on your karma in this lifetime, you could go to heaven. Through your own actions, you can create heaven, you can create hell, you could become an animal, you could become a jealous god, you could become a hungry ghost. In your next lifetime, those are, many people believe, this is literal destinations for incarnation, for rebirth. I'm skeptical. And irreverent and a whole bunch of other things. But what does make sense to me is this teaching, and I like this teaching and where I'm trying to get to in this teaching, is that this is mind states rather than physical locations. That these are experiences that we have as human beings. And I'd imagine that some of you have had periods in your life where you felt like you were in a bit of a hell realm, where it was, the pain was so consistent and persistent and overwhelming that you couldn't just muster any compassion for it. It felt like it was just pain and more pain. I'd imagine some of you have had the experience in this lifetime of feeling like a hungry, like that craving that all of us, I think, that are addicts can relate to, the hungry ghost, the alcoholic thirst, never enough, the addict's craving, never enough. No matter how many piles of crack I got. Not that I ever got a pile of crack. I wish I got a pile of crack. I would get like 240 pieces. But it would never have been enough. The craving for more is so persistent. And even that feeling of the hungry ghost of like wanting love or attention, and it's actually being offered, but you can't take it in. That kind of like, I actually just want some love and some compassion and somebody to understand me, and there's people sitting right there going, we love you and we understand you and we accept you, but you can't get it in, that pinhole. You know, yeah, bullshit. You're saying that, but I don't believe you. I don't trust you. And that can be that hungry ghost mentality around emotions. And or the animal-like violence sometimes that we've been in, where we just react. And probably in this lifetime too have had the experience of the balance, the human balance, or of the jealous gods. How often are you sitting here thinking, I'll be happy when I get more? And you sort of look around, you're like, I have most of this. I have everything I need. But for some reason, it's not enough. And that, you know, my neighbor has a way better lawnmower. I don't know. I won't be happy until I get a ride on lawnmower. I don't even have a fucking lawn, but I need a lawnmower. I need a lawn first. I need a lawnmower so that I can... something. But just that craving mentality, the greed mentality for something that we don't have, that we don't actually need. The more. Heaven realms, I don't think I said that much about heaven realms. Heaven realms are pleasant. And there's 27 different levels. There's only, so if you think that Buddhism is pessimistic about, we talk about suffering and hell and all of that, there's only seven hell realms, 27 levels of hell, of heaven realms. And all of these different levels of, like, it's pleasant. It's really pleasant. It's incredibly pleasant. It's so pleasant that you don't even remember anything that was ever unpleasant. It's so, you know, just like 27 levels of spiritual joy. And many of us have had experiences in this lifetime. I hope you've had some where you feel, it felt like it was so pleasant. This is just a heaven experience. But like all of those experiences that we had, all of these realms are impermanent. The definition of samsara, wandering, movement through, from realm to realm, from mind state to mind state. Hell is impermanent. No hell state lasts. No heaven state, right? Good news, bad news. You don't have to stay in hell forever. You just got to do some time. You don't get to stay in heaven forever. You just get to do some time. But they're all within samsara. And nirvana is liberation from samsara, the end of suffering. Then you no longer incarnate in this realm of craving, delusion, hatred. Because I see the world through this lens, and because the Buddha normalized for me the suffering in this world, and kind of just, you know, what he was saying 2600 years ago is that, like, this world is just a racist place. His culture was extremely racist. Now, he also spent his life trying to undo racism and to educate and to empower and to, so he wasn't complacent, but he said, he just looked at the world and he said, this world is just fueled by ignorance. We just are hurting each other constantly, people hurting each other. And that it's kind of from the beginning of time. You can't find a period of time where there's not ignorance, where there's not people oppressing each other. So the core Buddhist teaching is get free. Get free from those what's causing suffering, what's manifesting as all of the ignorance in the world. Get free from greed and hatred and delusion within your own heart and mind. One of the second teachings that the Buddha gives is called the Fire Sermon. He finds all of these fire worshippers and then he gives them a lecture on, he says, the whole world is burning with greed and hatred and delusion. He says, your eye is burning with greed for pleasure, with hatred of ugliness. He said, your tongue is burning with greed, hatred, and delusion. The ear is burning. The body is burning with this craving and aversion. The mind is fueled by the survival instinct. It's burning with greed for the next pleasant experience, for aversion to the last unpleasant experience, or the present one. So the core Buddha's teachings is saying, okay, this world is on fire with ignorance. And we have the Dharma is a fire extinguisher. And it's like when you're on the airplane and they say, please, in case of emergency landing, put on your own oxygen first and then assist your children or your friends or whoever. And so this is really what the Dharma is. Extinguish greed, hatred, and delusion. Put out this fire here. You have the most influence over yourself. You're handed a fire extinguisher. Here's the Dharma. This world's on fire. Samsara is on fucking burning. Here's a fire extinguisher. First put out yourself, then spend the rest of your life helping others. First put out your extinguish greed, hatred, and delusion from your own heart and mind, and then spend the rest of your life educating and empowering. And like the Buddha did, he spent his whole life teaching, but not just teaching. He was a political activist. He was going and speaking to the president and saying, the karma that you're creating for yourself is not worth the riches that you're creating for yourself. And then the violence, the war, the ignorance, the racism, the oppression. And not a lot of the presidents, kings, and that didn't listen to the Buddha, but he tried. He went and he spoke. He would go onto the battlefield at times to try to educate, to protest. He empowered women in a way that they'd never been empowered in the history of India, anyways, in his culture. By simply acknowledging their divinity, their ability for liberation, and by welcoming them into the monastic sangha and allowing them to leave their husbands and their families and come to be nuns. And, you know, acknowledging that what we're doing here has nothing to do with gender and that there's no hierarchy on what kind of body you're inhabiting. That it's the human potential to see clearly, respond wisely, to develop compassion. It has nothing to do with race or gender, or it's the human possibility. So I was thinking about these different realms of existence as mind states, and thinking about all of the suffering that's arising, and maybe many of you are feeling an extra dose of fear about the political climate, or anger, or I'm just wanting to acknowledge that and empathize, and I'm experiencing some of that too myself. I was very moved by everything that happened on Saturday. And we had a day long. We meditated. Some of you were here with me. We meditated all day. I really wanted to go down and be in the action. But there was already a scheduled meditation day here. So we sat, 50, 60 people sat in this room and meditated all day. And sent loving kindness and compassion and forgiveness and to everyone. And not just the oppressed, also to the oppressors. And it can be really hard to get your mind around. I know it has took me quite a while to get my mind around sending loving kindness to my enemies, sending compassion and wishes for happiness and freedom to people who are clearly confused and causing a lot of suffering to others. But this is the practice. This is the teaching. You don't have to do it all at once. Usually when I'm teaching forgiveness practice, I say, okay, if there's a whole bunch of people that you're not ready to forgive, that's okay. Set them aside and just forgive all the people that you are ready to and willing to forgive. And then work your way up to Trump. It's okay if that's set aside, and but there's the potential to get there. Or maybe it's not Trump for you. Maybe you're there may be some Trump supporters in the room. It may be somebody else for you. So whoever it is for you. The most difficult person in the world to love right now. And freedom from samsara, from these different realms, comes when actually we can love ourselves completely, forgive ourselves totally, have real compassion for how painful it is to have a mind that judges and compares. And your mind might not even stop doing some of those bad habits. But if you develop enough compassion and you stop taking it so personally, you extinguish all of the suffering around what it's like to have a human mind. Does that make sense to you? That's the way that makes most sense to me. Not that all of a sudden our mind is going to be perfect, but that we can shift our relationship to how imperfect it is to have a mind that just tends to compare, judge, fear. And we develop a sense of love and kindness. I don't know why, but I just had this image. During the meditation, I had this image of here's what happened while I was supposed to be meditating. The Bad Religion song from 1981, Fuck Armageddon, This Is Hell, came into my mind. And then that thought, fuck Armageddon, this is hell. And then I saw, I got a flash of the Bad Religion Suffer record where there's the teenage boy and he's on fire. And he's just like walking down the street angry and he's like has burst into flames. And I was thinking about like this how that's like, it's like that, the fire sermon, like where you're just on fire with. And I was like that. I lived my first half of my life just burning with hatred. And then the Dharma extinguished it. And then for some reason I was thinking about maybe the live streaming or something of like on Facebook where then the hearts float by. Facebook Live and like the hearts are floating by. And so this shift from like being on fire to like emanating these like love bubbles in this one incarnation from the hell realm through animal realms and through human realms and moments of heaven realms to living in a place where our mentality is much more this sort of loving bubble, hearts emanating rather than being on fire with hatred, even towards our enemies, even in times of great confusion and fear. And not that we have to be there or that we should judge ourselves for not being perfectly there, but that this is the Buddha's teachings and that this is our aspiration. There's that core and simple, often quoted teaching from the Buddha where he says, even amongst those who hate, walk in love, develop compassion. And that hatred will never cease by meeting it with more hatred. I mean, I was so angry and I hated so much when I was young because of all the hatred in the world. Meeting hatred with hatred. And then the Dharma teaches us to meet the hatred with compassion and to see why the suffering underneath and to have some compassion, some forgiveness, some empathy. Now, the one thing that I want to say is this thing about the fire extinguisher. One time I gave this talk and a week later somebody came by and they had got a new tattoo and it was a fire extinguisher with three diamonds in it. They said, I got it. I got the teaching. Dharma is like a fire extinguisher. The one thing that I want to say, although I believe it's true that the Buddha fully extinguished himself, I don't think that we need to wait until we're done. And most of us aren't. And I haven't been willing to say, like, not until I'm free am I going to try to create a positive change. That actually trying to create a positive change and getting politically and socially active and engaged and doing our best to come from a place of mindfulness and compassion and skillful response is part of our extinguishing, is part of our liberation. action and engagement as an integral part of being generous and loving and being an ally and being supportive of everyone who's being oppressed. From the inside out, but not waiting until we're free. As part of our seeking freedom. Make sense?
Yeah.
All right, these are my thoughts about the six realms and the increased suffering in our culture, and some encouragement to be gentle and kind and compassionate. Take care of ourselves and our own pain, our own suffering, while continuing to be proactive. And somebody that I was working with this morning was talking about how much extra they were suffering by every time they looked at Facebook. Mm. And Facebook can be a really advanced spiritual practice in these times. And actually, it's not a bad idea. What I suggested to her was to actually take a break from it, or to really just, you know, dip into it a little bit, because it's so easy. And because there's also something delicious about self-righteous anger. And he's like, oh, mother, you see what those fuckers are doing now? Did you hear the latest bad news? And I don't think we should... you know, bury our head in the sand. Paying attention is important. Responding is important. But also being gentle enough to say, you know, I can do 30 minutes a day of that. I can't look at it all day. I can catch up with, you know, in the morning about what happened yesterday. I don't need to stay in that realm of fear all day. I need to be gentle with my own process. Some of my thoughts and encouragements. Any questions before we run out of time? Please.
Can you say a
little
more about the realm of illusions?
Of what?
The realm of illusions.
So there's... all of the realms are fueled by greed, hatred, and delusion. Delusion is an aspect in every realm. And often delusion manifests as not understanding impermanence. So like you're in the heaven realm and you think this is going to last forever because you're delusional. Right? Like in the beginning of your relationship. This is going to be like this forever. Such a heaven realm, best sex ever. And then you're like, oh, that didn't last. So delusion is, or like when you're in hell, and it's the opposite delusion, like it's going to let, this pain is never going to go away. I'm going to suffer like this forever. But the delusion is, actually, even that pain is going to go away. It's going to change. Only 3 more years and 300 and everything's impermanent. We forget that. So that's a core delusion that we forget. We're not in harmony with that truth. We're not seeing it clearly. All right, probably a good enough place to leave it. Thank you all for listening. And as always, whatever I have to say is offered for your consideration, not to be believed, but to be reflected on, see what makes sense to you. There's lots of different teachers here. Come check out all of the different teachers at Against the Stream. See who resonates with you. Some, you know, you might not resonate with me, but you might listen to one of the other teachers and find that they're a better fit. So come check out the other teachers. Likewise for all their groups. There's some upcoming day-longs and retreats. The Memorial Day, the 3-day silent retreat, Vinnie Ferrar.